Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Plantagenet Princesses, The Daughters of Eleanor of Aquitaine and Henry II, by Douglas Boyd. Narrated by Gareth Richards. Chapter 1. Eleanor of Aquitaine, Founder of the Dynasty. Perhaps surprisingly to non-medievalists, the early Middle Ages saw a number of women exercise great power. In the 9th century, the Lombard queen Angilberga was given the honorific Consors Regni. In the 10th century, the Byzantine princess Theophano, married to Holy Roman Emperor Otto II, ruled the empire after his death as regent for her son Otto III. And in England, the Lady Ethelfled both ruled Mercia and led its army into battle. In the 11th century, Gisela, wife of Salian Emperor Conrad II, reigned with him as Consors Imperii. Early in the 12th century, Adelaide of Savona governed Sicily as regent until her son Roger II came of age. In Visigothic Spain, Petronila of Aragon and Urraca of Leon Castile were both queens regnant. Another of these strong and powerful women was the daughter of England's King Henry I, named Matilda or Maud. After the death in May 1125 of her first husband, the Holy Roman Emperor Heinrich V, she returned to the land of her birth at the age of 23, but kept the title of Empress for the rest of her life. Her father was a son of William the Conqueror, and succeeded to the throne on the allegedly accidental death of his brother William Rufus in 1100. Having lost his legitimate 18-year-old son William Adelin and several of his illegitimate sons in the disastrous sinking of the white ship off Barfleur in 1120, he named his only surviving legitimate child Matilda as his heir to the English crown and the Duchy of Normandy, forcing the Anglo-Norman barons of the island realm to swear allegiance to her. At the time, nobody called sons and daughters of royalty by the title prince or princess. For example, William Adelin was known as Guillemus Filius Regis, William the King's son, or Guillemus Filius Enrici, with everybody knowing which Henry was being referred to. So, strictly speaking, the title of this book is a misnomer, but a convenient one for modern listeners. Frustratingly, the only extant images of most of these women are the wax imprints of their seals that legitimize documents, and these give little impression of the person, even in colour photographs, and none in monochrome. When Henry I died in December 1135, his nephew, Stephen of Blois, was among the first to hear the news in Bologna. Breaking the oath he had sworn to recognize Matilda as the legitimate successor, he immediately took ship from there to England. He seized the treasury with the help of his brother, Bishop Henry of Winchester, bribed the citizens of London to support his claim, and persuaded William de Corbeil, Archbishop of Canterbury, to officiate at a coronation ceremony before the end of the year. Speed had won him the throne, allied to the dislike of many Anglo-Norman barons for the idea of being ruled by a woman. Although Matilda, Empress, was far from a shrinking violet, being described in the eulogy later pronounced by Bishop Arnulf of Lisieux as an exceptional woman devoid of womanliness. High praise indeed. Married for the second time to the lusty Count Geoffrey, the Fair of Anjou, who was 10 years her junior, the unwomanly empress nevertheless more than fulfilled her duty to give him a male heir by bearing him 3 sons. The Plantagenet dynasty takes its name from Geoffrey the Fair's custom of sporting a sprig of bright yellow flowering broom, in French genet, in his helmet, as a highly visible rallying point to his supporters during battle and in melees. Those violent free-for-all skirmishes at a tournament, confronting 2 teams of armed and mounted knights, where prisoners could be taken and held for ransom, and wounds and deaths were common. The earliest Plantagenets were from Geoffrey's county of Anjou in France, and therefore known as the Angevins, who ruled England 1154 to 1216. After the loss of the county of Anjou came the Plantagenets proper, ruling 1216 to 1399, followed by the cadet branches, usually referred to as the Houses of Lancaster and York, which ruled 1399 to 1485. Following the difficult birth of her third son, christened Henry after his regal grandfather, Matilda Empress decided, as had Henry I's Queen Matilda of Scotland after two births, to cease sexual relations with her husband, leaving him, as a chronicler once said, to take his pleasures elsewhere. Matilda's efforts to claim her legitimate inheritance on the death of Henry I were hampered by her last pregnancy. In the castle of Argenton in Normandy, she produced the third son, christened William, at the end of July 1136, by which time Stephen of Blois had already been acclaimed king by the citizens of London. It was not until September 1139 that an offer of support from her half-brother Robert of Gloucester emboldened Matilda to cross the Channel and claim her throne, with a mixed force of Angevin and Norman knights and nobles, the latter wavering somewhat in their support, because if Stephen won the confrontation, they stood to lose their estates in England. For the next decade, Matilda lived the precarious life of a female warlord in France and England. There was little contact with her sons until after her famous escape from Oxford Castle, wrapped in a white cloak during a snowstorm in December 1140, which was thought by Stephen's force besieging the castle too severe for any man, let alone a woman, to venture out of doors. Clambering down the unguarded riverbank, Matilda and a few companions walked through the blizzard on the ice of the Thames to Wallingford and made their escape. After her next major defeat by Stephen's forces at Winchester in 1141, she retreated to Devizes in Wiltshire, styling herself ambiguously as Domina Anglorum, or Lady of the English. Her eldest son, 9-year-old Henry Plantagenet, was sent to England to be brought up in Robert of Gloucester's household with the aim of making him the warrior statesman capable of realizing Matilda's frustrated political ambitions. 7 years later, Matilda fled the country and retired to the Norman capital of Rouen, a bitter and frustrated woman, leaving young Henry Plantagenet in England as figurehead for her forces in the bloody civil war known as the Anarchy, that ravaged England from 1139 to 1153. Here we run into a complication of medieval history. When Matilda died and her remains were taken to Rouen Cathedral, her epitaph there read, and still reads, Si j'y le fis, femme et mère d'Henri, which translates as, Here lies the daughter, wife, and mother of Henry. A witty epitaph for the daughter of England's King Henry I, wife of German Emperor Heinrich V, and mother of England's King Henry II. So many males were christened using a handful of names rendered in English as William, Henry, Robert, Geoffrey, and so on, that eponymous individuals had often to be distinguished by sobriquets, like Fat Louis, Henry the Proud, Geoffrey the Fair and William the Bastard, or toponyms, as in Robert of Gloucester or Stephen of Blois. Similarly, so many female children were named Matilda or Maud, Eleanor or various forms of Mary and Margaret, that use of the name alone can be confusing. When Empress Matilda's eldest son Henry married Duchess Eleanor of Aquitaine, his wife was an equally extraordinary woman. Her father, Duke William X, died on pilgrimage to the shrine in the Galician town of Santiago de Compostela at Easter 1137. As the older of his two surviving children, both girls, Eleanor inherited at the age of 15 the county of Poitou and Duchy of Aquitaine, a vast slice of southwest France. Because many young noblewomen were carried off for their dowries and married against their will, The Duke's death was hushed up by his companions when they returned to Bordeaux, for fear that some unruly vassal or neighbour might force Eleanor into marriage and become the new Duke of Aquitaine by fait accompli. Physically beautiful, highly intelligent, literate in and speaking several languages, Eleanor was described by one who knew her well as avenante, vaillante, et courtoise, or approachable, courageous, and courtly. In searching for a suitable match, her guardian, the politically shrewd Archbishop of Bordeaux, Geoffroy de la Rue, set his sights high, arranging for her to marry the 17-year-old French crown prince, Louis of the House of Capet. During the weeks it took Prince Louis to gather a suitable mezzanine of nobles and knights to make the 300-mile journey from the royal domain around Paris to Bordeaux, Eleanor and her younger sister, Aelith, also known as Petronila, were effectively under house arrest for their own protection, closely guarded so that no intruder could snatch either of them away and foil the Archbishop's plan. By the standards of the time, their quarters in the ducal palace of L'Ombreira were luxurious indeed. Society was then divided into three estates. In Latin, they were oratores, bellatores, et laboratores, those who prayed, those who fought, and those who laboured to support the totally unproductive knightly classes. It has been calculated that 23 entire families of serfs were required to support one modest knight and his household, and correspondingly more for grander knights and nobles. Outside the city of Bordeaux, the serfs laboured from dawn to dusk in the fields. In summer, the men stripped to their bray, a cross between loincloth and underpants, and the women laboured alongside them with their skirts hitched up to free their legs. They also cleared the vast forests of the region to make more productive land for their masters. So much land was cleared and so many new settlements established on it that even today 25% of all place names in southwest France date from this period. Eleanor and her sister Aelith wore ankle-length dresses of the finest cloth, some of silk trimmed with fur. The fashionable sleeves were so long they reached the floor and had to be knotted up out of the way much of the time. Their feet were protected from the cold flagstones of the palace by slippers of vair, V-A-I-R, the fur from the soft underbelly of squirrels, which became mistranslated as the homophone Verre, V-E-R-R-E, or glass in the fairy tale of Cinderella. Their arms and hands were embellished with bracelets and rings, which, like their earrings, were set with precious stones. They also used cosmetics like eyeshadow and rouge, and wore their hair long and loose, not confined in a wimple. Such glamour horrified the most famous monk in France, Abbé Bernard at the Benedictine Abbey of Clairvaux, who had a gift for words, deplored the beauty that is put on in the morning and laid aside at night. So perhaps Eleanor dressed down to meet her bridegroom when he finally arrived, for Prince Louis had been raised in the cloister until obliged by his elder brother's accidental death to abandon a religious career. The very disparate bride and groom were married in Bordeaux's Cathedral of St. André on 25th July 1137. Louis and his entourage did not impress the locals, his monkish demeanour earning him the label coulion, a word in the Occitan language of southern France meaning testicle or a stupid man. It seems likely that a fight broke out on the wedding day between the Frankish northerners and the proud Aquitaine nobility, for the bride and groom fled before the wedding feast ended, riding on relays of horses for 80 miles to reach the safety of the castle of Taillebourg before nightfall. On the death 2 weeks later of his long-suffering father, Louis VI, once known as Battling Louis, but for years called just Fat Louis, Eleanor became the 15-year-old Queen Consort of France. For her new husband had already been crowned in accordance with Capetian custom, to ensure there was no break in the succession. Her official coronation came later. Raised in the pleasure-loving ducal court of Aquitaine to enjoy music, poetry, and dance, accustomed since girlhood to flirting with sons of important vassals and courtly troubadours, some noble, some penniless, and free to ride the length and breadth of the duchy as the heir to her father, Duke William X, she understandably chafed at the restrictions imposed at Louis's court in Paris as proper conduct for a Frankish queen by her devout and forceful mother-in-law, Adelaide du Maurienne. Instead of complying, Eleanor did everything in her power to thwart the dowager queen, until finally driving her away from court to reside in one of her dower castles in Champagne. As pliant as his mother was dominant, Louis VII had been raised for high office in the church until his older brother broke his spine when thrown by his mount, stumbling over a pig, snuffling through the garbage in a Parisian street. The fatal injury compelled his younger brother, who would have made a good abbot, to act the part of monarch in the turbulence of the 12th century, a position he occupied from duty, and for which he had little liking. Once back in Paris after the trip to Bordeaux, Louis returned to the cloister, where he felt at ease, fasting with the other monks and sharing their all-night vigils. This was not how Eleanor had imagined married life would be. Accidental succession to a title was the only thing the royal couple had in common, and their relationship is summed up in Eleanor's frequent complaint, "I thought I had married a king, and found I had wed a monk." For a while, she used her excess energy in introducing southern comforts into the rude Capetian palace on the Ile de la Cité. Heating there was by charcoal embers in braziers, producing dangerous carbon monoxide, until she had a chimney installed in her quarters. Similarly, she had the narrow windows, through which came all the clamour of the citizenry and the stench of tanneries and sewage, glazed for warmth and quiet, and precious wall hangings brought from Aquitaine and Poitou. For her entertainment, scandalizing the religious members of Louis's court, she brought troubadours to recite poetry and sing songs for her pleasure. As to her queenly duty to provide a male heir for Louis, that was made more difficult by his preference for spending more nights in vigil on his knees at an altar than in her bed. Eleanor's first surviving daughter, Princess Marie, was the incarnation of her failure to fulfill the queenly duty, as was the previous stillbirth. In between births, her domination of the monkish monarch led him far from the religious paths for which he had been trained, into warfare and worse. Trying to live up to her expectations of a warrior husband, on one occasion he personally hacked off the feet of a recalcitrant vassal, so that he would be unable to mount a horse. The king's feeble build requiring many strokes of his sword to cut through bone and sinew. His worst excess under Eleanor's influence at the siege of Vitry-en-Pertois, during his 1143 invasion of Champagne, came when 1,300 men, women, and children were burned alive after the town was fired by his troops. Seeking sanctuary in the church, virtually the entire population died when its blazing roof fell in on them. For this, Louis was excommunicated and denied all the comforts of confession, the sacrament and the rituals of the Mass that he adored. When Louis sought the remission of his sin by taking the cross in the Second Crusade, there was no way Eleanor intended to miss the greatest adventure of her lifetime. Knowing that her personal wealth and the manpower of her vassals were essential to the Crusade, she ignored the interdiction of Pope Eugenius III on women accompanying their menfolk, who had taken a vow of chastity. Gathering a personal court of noble ladies to go with her meant that the long baggage train of ox-drawn carts, transporting their clothes, food, bedding, and rich pavilions for the night, had to set off before the crusading army to avoid causing a huge traffic jam. For part of the outward journey, the queen and her ladies rode bare-breasted to taunt Louis's flagging and exhausted troops in the Anatolian mountains. suffering by day and night injury and death from harassing hit-and-run Seljuk Turks. Meanwhile, back in France, the wives of the Crusader knights and barons were governing their possessions, never knowing whether their menfolk would return. Once in the Holy Land, excluded from access to Louis's daily councils with his religious advisers, Eleanor turned her back on them all, preferring to live in the sophisticated court of her uncle, Raymond of Toulouse, the Count of Antioch known for his exotic lifestyle and extramarital dalliances. When the crusade fizzled out after costing thousands of crusaders' lives, more from disease than in combat, she was abducted from Antioch by the Templar eunuch Thierry Galleron and forcibly removed from the Holy Land. Both on land and at sea, she resisted Louis's authority every inch of the way back to France, which seemed proof to gossiping tongues that her relationship with Raymond had been carnal. Adultery by a queen of France counted as high treason, never mind the close family connection between Raymond and herself. Breaking the journey, Eleanor was obliged to pay a courtesy visit with Louis to the papal court at Tusculum, where Eugenius's secretary, John of Salisbury, recorded her skillful presentation in Latin of her case for an annulment of the marriage to Louis, on the grounds of their consanguinity. In this, she cited the authority of the future Saint Bernard of Clairvaux, whom the Pope himself consulted on points of canon law. But Eugenius would have none of it. Smiling but firm, he ruled to her horror that her marriage to Louis was legitimate, and threatened with anathema anyone rash enough to refer in future to the matter of the royal couple's consanguinity. Taking no notice of this woman desperate to escape from a frustrating marriage that bound her to a man more drawn to the altar than her bed, Eugenius gave instructions that a double bed be prepared in his palace for the royal spouses, and spread with his own bed covers. What Eleanor did to contain her fury at being treated by Eugenius like a wayward child is not recorded. The next stop for Louis on the royal progress back to Paris was in Rome, the city from which Eugenius was exiled by its rebellious citizens. Squalid and reduced to less than a quarter of its imperial size by the barbarian invasions, the city once labelled eternal was a sad mockery of its former glory. As a devout pilgrim, Louis was welcomed at the gates by a deputation of senators representing the commune that had killed the previous pope trying to assert his pontifical rights only 6 years before. Guided by the senators, the pilgrim king toured the holy sites, accompanied by a claque chanting, "Beatus qui in nomine Domini venit. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord." Blessed, despite Eugenius's attempt to mend the rift by forcing Louis and Eleanor to sleep together for a few nights, Louis can have been under no illusion that she felt for him anything except contempt. They agreed on just one thing. It was unwise to linger in Rome at this time of year, when la malaria, literally the bad air, from the mosquito-infested swamps around the city, was blamed for killing off many visitors, although the natives appeared to have developed some resistance to the Plasmodium falciparum parasite carried by those mosquitoes. Resuming the interrupted journey back to France pregnant, Eleanor was furious with the Pope, and equally furious with the indecisive husband whose seed she carried in her womb, yet who failed in every respect to meet her expectations. In Aquitaine, her husband would have been a warrior poet, like her grandfather, the troubadour Duke William IX, who had carried on his shield the portrait of his mistress, the married Countess of Châtellerault, rightly known as La Dangerousa. This was in return, he said, for her bearing him on her body in bed. Back in Paris, on giving birth to a second daughter, whom she christened Aelith, after her own sister, Eleanor realized that the repeated failures to provide Louis with a son could be the key to unlock the marital prison to which Eugenius sought to confine her. Had this child been male, her enemies, and she had made many at Louis's court in Paris during the 15 years' marriage, might have come to overlook her scandalous conduct before and during the crusade. Although Louis was never hostile to her, his bishops were determined to rid the court of the whore of Aquitaine. The divorce that was later described by John of Salisbury as Louis's repudiation of an adulterous wife was negotiated at Beaugency, midway between Orléans and Blois. Although present, 30-year-old Eleanor was not permitted to speak, but listened in silence to the legal arguments of Louis's bishops and hers, who were led by Geoffroy de la Rue, the Archbishop of Bordeaux, who had arranged the marriage to Louis 15 years earlier. In defiance of Eugenius's threats of anathema made at Tusculum, the grounds used for separating the disparate couple lay in their known consanguinity. The marital bonds severed at long last, Eleanor rode with her small cortege of household knights back to the safety of her own possessions, in what was no regal progress, elegantly mounted on a side saddle. It was a hell-for-leather race, with her riding astride, in which she twice narrowly avoided ambushes by young nobles, intent on carrying off such a rich prize. Once safely inside the walls of her palace in Poitiers, the capital of her county of Poitou, her first priority was to wed a strong enough second husband to protect her domains by force of arms if necessary. Adjacent to the northern frontier of Poitou lay the territory of Anjou, ruled by 19-year-old Count Henry Fitz-Empress, who was also Duke of Normandy. The Fitz prefix was a corruption of the Latin filius, meaning son of, for the mother of this battle-hardened young warrior was Matilda Empress. Eleanor had met him before the crusade at Louis's court on the Ile de la Cité, where she discussed with Geoffrey the Fair the possibility of marrying Henry to her daughter, Princess Marie, in order to guarantee a powerful dynasty on the throne of France, should Louis die in Outremer without a male heir. But that discussion came to naught. On the 200-mile ride home from Beaugency in the heat of early September, father and son stripped off to cool down in the River Loire near their own city of Le Mans. Shortly afterward, Duke Geoffrey went down with a high fever, probably from swallowing contaminated river water. When he died 3 days later, the gossips on the Ile de la Cité accused Eleanor of sleeping with him, and saw in the manner and timing of his death the hand of God striking down an adulterer. But Geoffrey's three sons were alive and thriving, and although Henry Plantagenet was 10 years her junior, there had been a similar difference in ages when Matilda Empress married his father. In Eleanor, Henry saw a powerful, elegant, and beautiful woman in her prime, a lover of fashion, literate in several languages, and schooled in the harsh politics of 12th-century Europe. Ambitious to reclaim the English realm Matilda had lost, he knew Eleanor's immense wealth and territory, allied to his own, could tip the balance in his favour. Confident that he could get her pregnant with a son, despite Louis's failure to do so, he also calculated that, if she had failed to produce a son for him by the time of her menopause, he could, like Louis, invoke their consanguinity as grounds for divorce, put her away in a convent, and take a younger wife, with many more childbearing years ahead of her. When, after she had borne him sons and daughters, he initiated that plan, it was only Eleanor's unflagging strength of will throughout 15 years as his prisoner which foiled it. There were no stars in Eleanor's eyes either. She had at that moment no intention of being other than a dutiful wife and consort, and was confident that she would never say of him as she had of Louis, "He spent more nights on his knees at the altar than in my bed." With his powerful chest and shoulders, Henry walked with a horseman's swagger, already slightly bandy-legged due to all the hours spent in the saddle each day. Betraying his Viking ancestry, his face was freckled, his eyes grey, and his reddish hair was cut unfashionably short, because long hair became tangled by rubbing against the arming cap worn inside a metal helmet. His nickname, Henry Kurtmantle, referred to his habit of wearing a very short cloak that gave little protection from the weather, but made it easy to mount and dismount speedily. It was well known that, like his Viking ancestors, he went literally berserk if frustrated or defied, foaming at the mouth, falling to the floor and rolling in the soiled reeds and refuse of an audience hall, groaning like an animal in agony. Feudal custom required them to seek the permission of their feudal overlord, King Louis, before marrying, but they ignored that formality and were married on 18th May 1152 in Poitiers Cathedral, neither party worrying that their consanguinity was one degree closer than Eleanor's had been with Louis. Whatever feelings they may have had for one another initially, the marriage was a political union that united her Duchy of Aquitaine to the county of Poitou, with Henry's adjacent counties of Anjou, Maine, and Touraine, plus the important Duchy of Normandy. United by their marriage, this was a continuous swathe of territory that ran from the Spanish border to the English Channel, and constituted nearly half of Louis's kingdom. Chapter 2. Poems of Love and Bloodshed. The immediate consequence of the May wedding was a war into which Louis was pressured by his barons, among whom was King Stephen of England, who was also a vassal of Louis, as Count of Mortain and Boulogne. Stephen saw this civil war as the best way to weaken the chief competitor of his son, Eustace of Blois, for the English throne when he died. Louis's brother, Robert of Dreux, forgiven for attempting a coup d'etat while Louis and Eleanor were in Outremer, joined in. Count Theobald of Blois, who had just been betrothed to Eleanor's second daughter, two-year-old Aelith, also took the king's side, as did Henry's younger brother, Geoffrey Plantagenet. Both of these men had failed in their attempts to kidnap Eleanor in the flight from Beaugency. Count Henry of Champagne, just married to Eleanor's elder daughter, Marie, also supported Louis. When Princess Aelith was betrothed to Count Theobald V of Blois, both Eleanor's daughters were the property of her enemies. One of Louis VII's worst failings as king lay in his inability to think ill of anyone. It took him a while to realize that all the vassals in his coalition were not so much dutifully obeying their liege lord when called upon for knight service as hoping to grab plunder or claim a slice of Henry's and Eleanor's domains. They launched their invasion just after Midsummer Day, in the belief that Henry was preoccupied with preparations to invade England. As later events were to prove, he was adept at making enemies think he was doing one thing, when he was actually doing another, riding horses into the ground and laying waste to the land as he travelled. He invaded Robert of Dreux's territory, the speed and violence of his campaign so horrifying Louis, with the reality of the war unleashed in his name, that he fell ill with a fever and retreated as soon as the church called for a truce. Still furious, Henry rode back to Anjou, which his brother Geoffrey had attempted to raise against him, and captured Montsoreau Castle, garrisoned by Geoffrey's supporters. The youngest of Matilda's three sons, named William, had kept a low profile, having wisely decided to hitch his wagon to Henry's star. Far from weakening Henry's position as Stephen of Blois had hoped, Louis's failed invasion actually achieved the reverse, in forcing Eleanor's new husband to show his military prowess, thus warning his vassals and neighbours not to try and take advantage of his absence when he did eventually invade England. The short-lived war in France obliged Henry to delay that invasion until the following year, when he was far better prepared. But it also confirmed Eleanor's choice of her new husband as being of the stuff of her male ancestors in Aquitaine. The ducal couple spent the summer and autumn of 1152 in a grand feudal progress through her lands, with their household knights and courtiers, to make the point to her vassals and vavasseurs that they owed homage to a powerful new duke. Henry also used the trip to assess the castles and fortified towns of Gascony, both militarily and fiscally, and assure himself that his administrators, who had replaced Louis's appointees, were up to the job of taxing the notoriously independent barons of Aquitaine. Indifferent to food, Henry contented himself while travelling with gruel or bread, and expected his companions to do the same. His curiosity was insatiable, whether focused on trying out a horse, a hawk, a dog, or a weapon, or examining with his own hands a jewel or piece of material offered by a merchant. Enjoying the company of the few lay and religious vassals and foreign ambassadors with the intellect to amuse him, he dismissed them from his entourage the moment they could no longer be of service or entertainment value. That first journey, which Eleanor shared, fits the description by chronicler Peter of Blois of his own travels with Henry's court a few years later. If the king announces that he will not be travelling on a certain day, he is sure to be off at first light, forcing his men to rush around like madmen, rousing the pack horses and crashing the carts into one another. If he says he will be setting out early to a certain destination, he is sure to sleep to noon. The loaded pack horses and carts stand waiting. The outriders snooze. Everyone mutters and ponders. At last, an inquiry is sent to the court prostitutes to see about the king's travel plans, for this kind of court follower often knows the palace secrets. That was a euphemism for saying how Henry spent many nights. Yet there was nothing haphazard about his apparently erratic hyperactivity, which later enabled him to govern the enormous spread of territory on both sides of the English Channel, later known as the Angevin Empire, using methods of communication that had not changed in 1,000 years. While confusing everyone else, Henry knew exactly what he was about, but was too paranoid to tell anyone. Another chronicler, Arnulf of Lisieux, described the relationship between the courtiers travelling with Henry thus: "Friendship among those who are summoned to give the king counsel and undertake his business is one of the rarest things. Anxious ambition dominates their minds. Each of them fears to be outstripped by the endeavours of the others, and so is born envy, which necessarily turns immediately into hatred." The chronicler Walter Mapp, although not so generally respected by modern historians as he was, called greed the main motivation of the court, where laughter was vanquished by care, and Peter of Blois said that court life was death to the soul. During the long ride through Eleanor's domains, of which he was duke by marriage, Henry was affable enough in giving alms to religious establishments and confirming treaties. Yet when thwarted by a religious or lay vassal, he reacted violently, as when tearing down the newly built walls of Limoges and its bridge across the river Vienne as a reminder to his new vassals and vavasseurs not to try and take advantage of his absence in the invasion of England planned for the following year. Those plans were also the reason he took an interest in the tuna and whale fisheries along the Gascon and Pontivan littoral, of which the vessels could be useful in transporting hundreds of men and horses across the channel with him. A different wife might have retired from their hectic progress to the civilized comforts of the comital palace at Poitiers, or the ducal palace at Bordeaux. But the woman who had defied the Pope to ride across the Anatolian mountains on the Second Crusade was tougher than that, and also determined to establish her own position in the marriage from the outset. Although rapidly realizing she would never have over her new husband a fraction of the influence that she had enjoyed over Louis. The tour of inspection was abruptly cut short after receipt of encouraging intelligence from Matilda's partisans in England. After hastening north to gather his forces on 8th January 1153, Henry defied the winter storms by setting sail from Barfleur with a small fleet of 26 vessels, leaving Eleanor pregnant in France. England was a country whose native inhabitants still spoke Low German dialects like Anglo-Saxon, but Henry could speak Norman French, the language of the ruling aristocracy descended from the barons and knights of William the Conqueror's army in 1066, who had taken English noblewomen as wives in order to claim their lands. He was also fluent in Latin, the language in which legislation and charters were recorded, and had some English acquired when living in Robert of Gloucester's household. Landing in England again on 9th January 1153 with an army of around 3,000 men, Henry found that being the most powerful man in France was not enough to oust King Stephen. Despite widespread dissatisfaction with the raping and looting of the undisciplined Flemish mercenaries employed to keep the usurper king's unstable regime in power, Henry settled down to a long campaign, considering that he had little to fear from a rebellion in his French domains, with Matilda in control of Normandy, and Eleanor acting as regent for his other domains. The two women kept their distance. A pious autocrat, Matilda accepted the political necessity for her son's marriage, but had no welcome for a daughter-in-law fresh from another man's bed, and within the prohibited degrees of consanguinity. Nor was Eleanor inclined to curry favour from such a mother-in-law. Leaving her uncle, Raoul de Fay, to govern Aquitaine, she moved to the capital of Henry's county of Anjou. In Rouen, all was sobriety and pious observance at the Empress's court. In Angers, men at Eleanor's court were required to prove their valour, but also to speak eloquently, dress well, and have fashionably cut hair when in her presence. Louis had banished from his court Eleanor's trouvère and other entertainers, whom he accused of distracting men's minds from their faith. They and others flocked to Eleanor's new court, where she and her intimates were treated to the best of contemporary European poetry and music. It was certainly about this time, and it may well have been there, that the code of courtly love originated. For at Angers, men were set convoluted tasks by the ladies of the court, who sat in sometimes cruel judgment on their suitability. This was a reversal of the convention that every woman of whatever rank owed deference to her father, brothers, and husband, simply because they were male. In the words of a poem by an anonymous Trouberitz, for ladies also wrote romantic poetry, Domna dua son drut for anor com ad amic, mas non com asenor. The lady must honour her lover like a friend, but not as her master. Since Eleanor's troubadours were writing to please a demanding autocratic patroness, some have taken this to mean that their verses represent a normally hidden side of her personality, that yearned for the joy of abandoning herself to the caress of an adoring lover. A dream that no noble woman, let alone a queen or princess, could afford to indulge. One of the many disservices in Hollywood's depictions of the Middle Ages is the image of an itinerant jongleur, or minstrel, strolling from castle to castle with a lute slung over his shoulder, inventing the songs to entertain each host. The troubadours who composed the songs and poetry were mostly of knightly families. The troubadours who composed the songs and poetry were mostly of knightly families, although Guillaume Figuera was a tailor's son, and Bernard Evontadorn's parents were a sergeant-at-arms and a kitchen-maid working in the bakery of the castle of Vontadorn. The only codification of what came to be called courtly love was Andreas Capellanus's Treatise d'Amour, according to which when a man catches sight of his beloved, his heart beats faster. The author wrote this work at the command of Eleanor's daughter, Marie de Champagne. Opinions differ as to whether it was a cynical comment on courtly behaviour, or genuine advice to a young pupil of Andrew the Chaplain. At Eleanor's court, Bernard de Ventadorn put it poetically. Quand you l'avez, be mes pavan al hul, al vis à la couleur, quand si tremble de par, cum falafuela contre le vent. When I see her, what's in my mind shows, in my eyes and my pale cheek. What is this fear that makes me weak, trembling like a leaf in the wind? At some point during Eleanor's journey through the Limousin, with her new husband, Bernard attached himself to her household after being banished from Ventadorn for becoming too close an admirer of its countess, Marguerite de Turenne. 5 years younger than Eleanor, he was endowed with a fine voice, poetic talent and handsome good looks, gaining her patronage, if not her heart. In his poem, Quand va la lausette, mauve de joie, sas alas contral ra, he likens his visibly pregnant mistress to a swallow, its wings joyously silhouetted against the sun as it soars so impossibly high above him in station. Alice ton que j'avais seba d'amour et tant petite en sait, car you d'amour non posque tener celui, don j'appro non arai, anc non agui de mi poder, ni no fui mi dolor, en si con le se, en so olvese e un miral qui mot me plai. Alas, I who thought much to know of loving, yet know so little, I cannot help but love her, though she will never be mine. Before her I am powerless, and really not myself at all, since the moment she met my gaze in a mirror and put me in her thrall. Henry cared little for rhymes and rhymers, and less still for the love poems of troubadours like Bernard. But when rumours of Eleanor's admirer reached him in England, Bernard was summoned thither. If he did sing songs for his supper while with Henry's comfortless court, they would have been from the very different body of troubadour compositions, vaunting warfare and other manly pursuits, that were composed by, among others, Bertrand de Bourne, the troublesome lord of Hortford Castle. Tournaments, then, were not the organised ritual of later years, with two mounted knights thundering towards each other with lances poised, separated by a stout wooden barrier. That was dangerous enough, but the melee, which was a swirling mass of armed and armoured men and mounts, usually started in a town square, with two teams of knights charging straight at each other. They could roam for miles across the fields and orchards, causing much damage to crops as pursuers chased after wealthy knights to take them for ransom. To be unhorsed often meant death beneath the hooves of the horses, as one of Eleanor's sons was to find out. Bertrand de Bourne gloried in the whole scene. Bella me presa de blazo, cobe de teint, de mille et blaus. D'entre son et de gonfanon, de diversa couleur tretaus, tenda et tra peric pavilos tendre, lanza frasa escuts, tranca effendre, elm brunits et colp dona et prendre. The melee with its thousand charms, shields vermilion and azure, standards, banners, coats of arms, painted in every bright colour. The pavilions, the stands, the tents, shattered lances, shields split and bent, blows given, taken, helmets dented. The violence of the melee was justified as training for war, but Henry banned them in England because he saw those assemblies of several hundred and sometimes thousands of armed men as a possible cloak for a rebellion. Defying Henry's orders, Bernard returned to Angers and was abandoned there when Eleanor's court moved on. Something of his despair may be deduced from his decision to enter a monastery and afterwards use his voice only to sing the offices. On 17th August 1154 in Normandy, her relief redoubled by the knowledge that she had erased forever the stigma of having produced only daughters for Louis. Eleanor gave birth to a son. Learning of this in Paris, Louis saw it quash the faint chance of either of his daughters inheriting the Duchy of Aquitaine through their mother. Within a few days of the birth, she was resuming her normal life, her baby put out to a wet nurse, and her own breasts tightly bound to inhibit the swelling natural in lactation. Christening the boy child William, after her father and grandfather, and all the other Williams among her ancestors, Eleanor honoured him with the courtesy title Count of Poitou, without asking Henry's advice. Since the Counts of Poitou were by tradition also Dukes of Aquitaine, the infant seemed to have a glorious future ahead of him, possibly including the throne of England. But this was not to be. Never had Eleanor felt more secure, having every reason to believe that she had forfeited none of her independence in return for her new status. Many minor events bear this out. When issuing charters at this time, she included no mention of Henry indicating his assent. When Pope Anastasius IV confirmed by a papal bull the privileges of the foundation of Notre Dame de Santa on 29th October of that same year, the list of donors included Louis of France, Eleanor and Aelith, but of Henry there is no mention. Even that wily churchman Geoffroy de la Rue, forever sniffing the winds of change, went on record by stating in a charter of 25th September 1153 that Aquitaine acknowledged only the authority of its duchess. A few days after the birth of William, Eleanor received news that King Stephen's son, Eustace of Bologna, had choked to death during a meal near Bury St. Edmunds on the day after her confinement. Worn out with strife and hoping to avoid another civil war, the grieving King of England formally accepted Henry Fitz Empress as his legal successor after protracted negotiations that dragged on into mid-November. At Christmas of that year, Archbishop Theobald of Canterbury enshrined the arrangement in a treaty witnessed at Westminster by 14 bishops and 11 earls of the realm. It was a wonderful stroke of luck for Eleanor's ambitious young husband, because Stephen of Blois was in his late 50s, and thus an old man by the standards of the time. So, Henry looked certain to be one of the two most powerful monarchs in Europe within a few years. The other was the German emperor. Returning to France in high spirits, Henry summoned his wife and infant son to Rouen, where they moved into the palace built by his grandfather. Henry made peace with Louis, in consideration of 1,000 silver marks as a fine or gift. Louis ceased to include Duke of Aquitaine among his titles, which he had been doing since the divorce, on the strength of the specious argument that Eleanor had become Duchess by virtue of her marriage to him as successor to Louis the Fat. In Bordeaux, during September 1154, Geoffroy de la Rue sniffed the political winds again, and proclaimed that the master of Aquitaine was henceforth Henry of Anjou. Under the obligations of homage for his domains in France, Henry owed military service to King Louis when called upon. After recovering from some unspecified but severe illness, which may have been an attack of the malaria then endemic in Europe, he rode at the head of a large body of men to help Louis pacify the ever-restless Vexin, a contentious territory between Normandy and the royal possessions. It was during this time that messengers from Archbishop Theobald in Canterbury arrived a few days after Stephen's death on 25th October to announce that the Duke and Duchess of Aquitaine and Normandy could now add King and Queen of England to all their other titles. Seemingly stunned by Eleanor's rapid rise in the world since their divorce, Louis left Paris on pilgrimage to Compostela. He did not ask her and Henry for the safe conduct through their lands to which he was doubly entitled, both as a pilgrim and as the liege to whom they owed homage for their possessions in France, but travelled by a longer roundabout route via Montpellier, Barcelona, and Aragon, which had the advantage of giving him the opportunity to visit the Christian courts of northern Spain, searching for a new wife. With no intention of letting the 20-year anarchy of Stephen's reign continue a day longer than necessary, Henry wanted to claim the English throne rapidly and show the Anglo-Norman magnates from the outset that things were going to be very different from now on. In 2 weeks, he had assembled a reasonable force to do this. With a small retinue of personal servants, Eleanor joined him at Barfleur. There, surrounded by Frankish nobles and prelates who had witnessed or heard of her humiliation after the abduction from Antioch, she confronted them in triumph, requiring from each man the proper deference due to the mother of their overlord's son, 7 months pregnant with another child by him. As though to remind Henry that his power was only temporal, November gales blew in from the Atlantic day and night, making it impossible to put to sea. They were storm-bound in Barfleur until 7th December, when, determined to celebrate Christmas wearing the crown of England, Henry ignored the lesson of the white ship sinking in that very place and embarked himself, Eleanor, and the infant Prince William on a grey sea under a leaden sky in a vessel almost identical, clinker-built with high bow and stern, rigged with a lateen sail that should enable them to cross against the westerly winds and swell. The weather was still so bad that even with sails reefed, the convoy was scattered before nightfall, after which the usual station-keeping devices of horn lanterns and bugle calls were useless. For more than 24 hours, the ships were buffeted by wind and tide until widely separated. Henry and Eleanor first set foot on the soil of their new kingdom in the New Forest near Lyndhurst. Their first call was at Winchester to secure the royal treasury, commandeering fresh horses on the way and gradually acquiring a cortege of Anglo-Norman prelates and nobles, drawn to Henry's banner by the news of his apparently miraculous arrival, borne on the wings of the storm. From Winchester, they progressed to London, without a hand lifted or a sword drawn in protest, thanks to Archbishop Theobald of Canterbury, who had assembled the bishops of the realm to acclaim their new monarch. The traditional setting for coronations was Westminster Abbey, a few miles up river from the city of London, where a ford was the main crossing point before the Romans built the first bridge connecting the road from Dover directly with the city. Because the adjoining palace had been vandalized by Stephen's mercenaries during the Civil War and was uninhabitable, Henry and Eleanor set up court south of the River Thames in Bermondsey, then an island surrounded by marshes. On the Sunday before Christmas, they were crowned King and Queen of England in a curious mixture of pomp and squalor at Westminster Abbey. The common people were miserably poor after all the fighting, but there was no shortage of food for the Anglo-Norman nobles at the coronation feast. If the venison and game birds being served were fresh, the beef and pork had been salted for winter consumption when the animals not required for breeding were slaughtered in November. As a result, dried herbs, pepper, and other imported spices were used heavily in stuffings, sauces, and marinades, to disguise the residual saltiness in the meat after its soaking in water, and to cover the unpalatable taste of bad meat. There were omelets, stews, pies and fish in abundance. To cleanse the palate, there was a wide range of sweet desserts, fruit stewed and candied, also jellies, tarts, waffles and wafers. While Henry's native subjects preferred to drown their sorrows in mild ale, less likely to be polluted than the water in their wells, because fermentation killed many bacteria, their Anglo-Norman masters preferred wine. From France, of course, although there were vineyards in England, as far north as Ely at the time. The wayfarers who made and served the thin pastries eaten at the end of the meal with sweet white dessert wine were also the cabaret. There were tumblers of both sexes, storytellers, conjurers and jugglers, farters, singers and musicians playing bowed and plucked stringed instruments, harps, lyres, flutes of various kind, shawms, bagpipes and other instruments. Chrétien de Troyes, a contemporary poet employed at the court of Marie de Champagne, describes a wedding at which young girls sang and danced. Jesters, whose original function had been retelling the res gestae, or great deeds of past heroes, were now jokers, whose irreverent humour was indulged so long as their wits were faster than those of the victims they mocked, enabling them to keep the majority of the audience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.